Hello and welcome everybody to a new video from Juggler66, Hour of the Truth. This one is called Pro-Germanism of Pope Pius XII, Hitler's Pope, also called. Yeah? And it is chapter 12 of the book Behind the Dictators. And it is the last chapter of the book, because after this chapter there only follows something that is not written by the author himself, an appendix called A Vital Condition for Lasting Peace. But I will not read this because it is not necessary, not interesting in the view of what we've read up to here, the 11 chapters before and this 12th chapter giving an end to it. It is not written by the author himself. It is completely secular. It is without any insight on the Vatican, on very much of this writing. So I will end the book reading of Behind the Dictators with chapter 12 called Pro-Germanism of Pope Pius XII. And before I start, I just want to say I enjoyed very much reading this book, because you know that I am from German roots. And I think, even though there are a lot of Germans sub to my channel who do not speak English, I hope that the ones who speak English will gain a lot of knowledge from this out-of-print book from an author who died just 5 years or so. No, he died in 1950, so just 8 years after publishing this book in 1942. And I hope that my German brethren will get a lot out of it. But even more, I hope, because I'm doing this now in 2016, that all my American brethren will take a lesson out of it and understand when the Bible says there is nothing new under the sun, and when everybody says, oh, history just repeats itself, that they see through how the Roman Catholic Church worked together with fascism in Europe in the time of the 1930s, 1940s, what is covered here in this book, that they see how they do the exact same thing today in the United States of America. And even when you cannot stop it, you can at least, when you understand it, warn your neighbor, whom, I guess, because you call yourself a Christian, you love, and make him attend, make him knowledgeable of the facts given here in this book. That ends now with chapter 12, Pro-Germanism of Pope Pius XII. It is not generally known that the reasons which led the Allies to exclude the Pope from the peace conference after the First World War were connected with the activities of Monsignor Eugenio Pacelli, who later became Antichrist, Pope Pius XII. We will first go into his 12 years in Germany. Monsignor Pacelli's life has been divided between his native Italy and Germany, where he spent 12 crucial years. Nuncio in Munich in 1917, during World War I, he has dealt with the Kaiser and with the Republic, with revolutionary committees and Nazi conspirators. He was a friend of Friedrich Ebert, first president of the German Republic, the Weimar Republic as you probably know it, and an intimate of Germany's monumental Hindenburg, under whose presidency he concluded a concordat with Prussia. He witnessed Hitler's tempestuous beginnings in Munich and the machinations of his agents in Berlin. Viscount d'Abernon, Britain's first ambassador to the Weimar Republic, in his memoirs calls Pacelli, quote, the best informed man in the Reich, unquote. His mission in Munich in 1917 was not the starting point of his German career. Even before the First World War, Monsignor Pacelli had been Papal State Secretary Gasparri's most trusted expert on German affairs. It was no mere chance that in the very first month of the war he was stationed in Switzerland, where he started, with great devotion, tact and zeal, a truly Christian, read, Catholic and humanitarian movement, the exchange of prisoners of war. Yet, while there he had frequent contacts with the Kaiser's propaganda chief, his old acquaintance Matthias Erzberger, for years a leading member of the Reichstag's Catholic Center Party. It was with Matthias Erzberger in Switzerland that Pacelli engaged in the negotiations which deeply shocked Italy's liberal government and which accounted largely for its opposition to the Vatican's participation in the peace settlement. Before I read further, just going back a few sentences. It reads, even before the First World War, Monsignor Pacelli had been Papal State Secretary Gasparri's most trusted expert on German affairs. Papal State Secretary Gasparri. Who was Gasparri? Well, he became Pope Pius XI. And Eugenio Pacelli, who we are talking about here, later becomes Pope Pius XII. Interesting. What they called, or so-called, apostolic succession, isn't it? All his life, Eugenio Pacelli has taken an active part in one of the most secret complex intrigues, read conspiracies, of our time. The patient struggle of the papacy to regain and extend its temporal power. In this struggle, for the last 70 years, whenever a major issue of international politics was at stake, the Vatican has hitched its star to the Germanic juggernaut. Now, what was Pius XII's or Eugenio Pacelli's tie-up with fascism? The Lateran Treaty in 1929 between the Vatican and Mussolini restored the sovereignty of the Pope and allied the Vatican to Italian fascist government. This, remind you, is the beginning of the healing of the wound inflicted to the sea beast, the first beast of Revelation 13. It also brought about a worldwide coordination of authoritarian powers of the corporative and nationalistic type and the eventual entrance of Italy into the camp of Nazi Germany. Thus, in 1940, after the fall of France and the proclamation of Marshal Pétain's fascist French state, it looked as if in the present world war, Vatican policy had gained substantial progress where it had failed in the previous war. At the end of this war, World War II, when delegates of all countries will gather in an international peace conference, the author says here prophetically, the Pope, for the first time in more than 100 years, will again be represented as a ruling monarch, provided that his miniature state is still intact. And it is. It even is today, in 2016. He expects to exercise considerable authority, although, as a temporal ruler, his influence will be less than that of Pope Pius VII at the Congress of Vienna in 1815. Today, as Chief of State of Vatican City, he possesses only a formal juridical status. But he will have real power because of his self-assumed status as, quote, Chief of Christendom, unquote. Yeah, Christendom, Catholicism, which is not the same. A notion cleverly introduced for more than 10 years into public international discussions and, after centuries of obliteration, readmitted even in non-Catholic countries. As Chief of Christendom, read Chief of Catholicism, the Pope would take rank above all other chiefs of state, just as the Papal Nuncio on the continent of Europe, as well as in Latin America, automatically becomes Dean of the Diplomatic Corps. The Chief of Christendom, which I like to call more the Chief of Catholicism, because, remind you, dear listener, Catholicism is not Christendom. But the next part of this chapter is called Chief of Christendom. The idea of a Chief of Christendom, himself also a Chief of State, presiding over an assembly of Chiefs of State, is a medieval conception which has no place in our 20th century democratic world. But it is the restoration of the old world order. For that, please check out Tom Fress's reading and discussion of the book The Global Vatican from 2015 on First Amendment Radio under his name of Inquisition Update. A link to the video playlist on my Vimeo channel will be provided in the description box of this video, and I will eventually upload there all 99 parts of Tom's Inquisition Update's very important work that he did on First Amendment Radio. But I'm limited to 500 megabytes upload a week, and I cannot even upload two videos each week because sometimes they are 252, 253 megabytes. And when you upload two, well, then you go beyond 500. So sometimes I only can upload one video, but eventually they will all be uploaded there. Be sure of that. Okay, I will repeat the sentence to get us back into the chief of Christendom. Huh? The idea of a chief of Christendom himself, also a chief of state, presiding over an assembly of chiefs of state, is a medieval conception which has no place in our 20th century democratic world. It has been revived for political reasons, and unless denounced, will prove a dangerous challenge to freedom and progress. Just look around where you are today in the United States of America, or where you are today in Europe, and you will see that it is a challenge to freedom and progress by making all one again, as under Babel. For just as the equality of individuals, the equality of nations is a fundamental principle of democracy. To recognize one chief of state as senior and permanent hierarchical chief of all other states would be to set up an authoritarian world monarchy, even though the term monarchy may not be used. Caesar Augustus in ancient Rome refused the unpopular title of king and preferred to be called imperator, a dignity which the Roman Republic used to bestow temporarily upon a supreme commander appointed in a national emergency. The United States of America is in a state of national emergency since March 9, 1933, by the way. Hitler played the same trick in Germany. It would have been easy for him to have had himself crowned emperor. He could have done that. I don't think that he would have had any or many opposers to that. Instead, he found it more expedient to leave the constitution of the Weimar Republic legally in force and to assume the less conspicuous name of Führer or leader, the Mein Führer standing for the old-fashioned Your Majesty or Sire. Protestant nations, it is to be hoped, will not accept this new international slogan of a chief of Christendom, which the Holy See is trying to smuggle into general acceptance. Today, in 2016, we are smarter or more learned than the author was when he published this book in 1942. Protestant nations, it is to be hoped, will not accept this new international slogan of chief of Christendom, which the Holy See is trying to smuggle into general acceptance. Last year, in September, the Antichrist Pope Francis was speaking before a joint session of Congress in the United States of America. Several American presidents calling him Holy Father, while the Bible says, call no man on earth your father, for there is one who is your father, who is in heaven. Right? So the fears of our author here have become reality. Whatever the illusions of clerical politicians who believe in the re-establishment of the supranational rule of the papacy, their schemes are bound to work to the advantage of imperialist Germany. Recent statements by Mr. Elmer Davis, as well as Vatican diplomatic activity, seem to indicate that the Axis powers are seeking the mediation of the Holy See. Of course, the Antichrist, fomenting all the wars in the world throughout, through the Jesuit order, Regimini Militantis Ecclesiae, assumes the role of Prince of Peace, as he is, according to Catholic teaching, the Vicar of Christ on earth. And because nobody sees the deception and exposes the Jesuit order for what they really are, Regimini Militantis Ecclesiae, the Church at War, the world turns to the Pope for reconciliation and managing peace treaties. Who is the real Prince of Peace? That's right, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and not the Antichrist of Scripture, who betrays the whole world, and the whole world wanders after the beast that the head of the Roman Catholic Church, the Antichrist, writes, as that church is the woman arrayed in purple and scarlet and decked with precious stones, as we read in the book of Revelation chapter 17. Wake up! Wake up! It's about time! If the government of the Protestant Kaiser tried to enlist the support of the Vatican, there's no reason why Hitler's predominantly Catholic Greater Germany should retain from appealing to the Pope now that even the most fanatical Nazis can no longer hope to conclude the war by a crushing Axis victory. The last time the Pope's collaboration in post-war arrangements was made impossible by Article 15 of the Secret Treaty of London between Italy and the Allies. This explicit exclusion of the Pope from peace conference has ever since been branded by Catholic politicians as a villainous maneuver of international Freemasonry. They still point to the absence of a delegate of the Holy See at Versailles and Neuilly in 1919 as the deeper cause for the failure of the peace treaties and of the League of Nations. This is a point that we can probably discuss a long time, but the point was, the Pope couldn't have been there in 1990 at the peace treaty negotiations after World War I because his temporal power was not restored. Between 1870 and 1929, the Pope locked himself into a prison that is in the Vatican. And the keys of that prison were on the inside. Never a pope left in the time between 1870 and 1929 the Vatican. He never left. He never was outside. Because he had no temporal power. But with the restoring of the temporal power in 1929, all that changed. So that's why the League of Nations was only a forerunner of the United Nations that we have today, after the temporal power of the Pope was restored with the Lateran Treaty in 1929. So the author says here, they still point to the absence of a delegate of the Holy See at Versailles and Neuilly in 1919 as the deeper cause for the failure of the peace treaties and of the League of Nations. Well, of course, because the Pope didn't have the power then. But he regained his power in 1929, just in time, when all Europe became fascist. Through elections, so-called, like in Italy, or through wars, like in Spain, or so-called elections in Germany when Hitler came to power in 1933, and afterwards he conquered all of Europe and made all of Europe under his jurisdiction, meaning made it fascist. Until then, until 1929, the Pope was locked up in the Vatican. And that's why they point to the absence of a delegate of the Holy See at Versailles, because the Pope had no temporal power at that time. Now we go a little bit into the Treaty of London. the real history of Article 15 of the Treaty of London and the reasons for the exclusion of the Pope from the peace conference have never been fully understood in this country, United States of America. The American public does not know that Italy demanded and that the Allies agreed upon the exclusion of the Pope from the future peace settlement because they had evidence that some of the most prominent clericals at the Holy See were favoring the Central Powers and had for months discussed and planned a secret German proposal to reconstitute in Rome a papal state with internationally guaranteed access to the sea. Very interesting what all came before the Lateran Treaty in 1929, and we will right go into this. Only in face of the irrefutable fact that, in the midst of a terrible war, Vatican politicians were abusing the Christian peace apostolate of the Supreme Pontiff to further their temporal interests and to extend their power, even at the expense of their native land, these papal politicians were all Italians, that the Allies agreed to Italy's demand. Although from the beginning of the war it was obvious that the sympathies of the Vatican could not be with Protestant England, could not be with anti-clerical France or Orthodox Russia, Allied statesmen, some of them devout Roman Catholics, found it hard to believe that papal diplomacy would place its political interests before those of millions of French and Belgian Catholics who had become victims of German aggression. Now we go into Matthias Erzberger. The story of Germany's collaboration with the Vatican in the last war has been told, as so often before, by a devout Roman Catholic who had himself been on the inside of the intrigue and who, intrigue or conspiracy, and who, vain by nature and bitter from disappointment, spoke out when he felt that he had been abandoned by his former associates. Our witness is none other than Matthias Erzberger, leading member of the Catholic Center Party, militant German imperialist in 1914, Germany's foreign propaganda chief until 1917, means during the war, when he promoted the Reichstag's famous peace resolution, imperial undersecretary of state, leader of the German armistice delegation, minister of finance, and one of the fathers of the Weimar Republic. He was assassinated in 1921 by young German nationalists a few months after the publication of his outspoken book, My Experiences in the World War, in German Erlebnisse im Ersten im Weltkrieg, von Reichsfinanzminister A.D. Matthias Erzberger, which means Minister of Finance in the Reich, out of service, Matthias Erzberger, his book. Okay? My Experiences in the World War. Probably interesting to read also. Now, secret Vatican treaty with Germany. One of Erzberger's chief objectives, and don't forget we are still speaking about all the influence that Eugenio Pacelli, the later Pope Pius XII, Antichrist Pius XII, has had in that time. One of Erzberger's chief objectives was to secure diplomatic immunity and extraterritorial rights for the Holy See. Now we see everything that came up that led to the Lateran Treaty in 1929, so I want you to pay attention. As early as October 1914, a few weeks after his appointment as Chief of Foreign Propaganda, he suggested the establishment of a small neutral papal state in that part of Rome which lies on the left bank of the Tiber, with a corridor to the sea and port. His negotiations finally led to a draft treaty regarding the recognition of the temporal power of the Pope. You see where this is leading? This treaty, he says, had the approval of competent personalities of the German Foreign Office. The first version was submitted by Erzberger and his friends in Vatican circles in the beginning of 1915. It was formulated with characteristic thoroughness. The following extracts of this secret treaty are from Erzberger's book, pages 127 and following. And here we can actually read the preparation of what is known as the Lateran Treaty from 1929, as I already said. Oh, the Germans did according to the order of Pope Leo XIII to become the battle sword of the Church and even paved the way for the healing of the wound of Revelation 13 to the first the sea beast. Article 1 of this secret treaty we read, quote, "The temporal power of the Pope is recognized by the high contracting powers as extending over a territory including Vatican Hill and a strip of land connecting it with the Tiber and with the railroad to Viterbo and to be designated as Church State." Unquote. Article 2. "The Church State is permanently independent and neutral. Its independence and neutrality are guaranteed by the high contracting powers." Article 3. "Sovereign of the Church State to the Pope. During the vacancy of the apostolic chair, the sovereignty is exercised by the College of Cardinals." Article 4. "Citizens of the Church State are papal legates, nuncios and internuncios, members of the papal court, officials of the administrations and palaces of the Church State, members of the palace guards, as well as ecclesiastics permanently residing in the Church State." Article 5. "The Kingdom of Italy pledges to render the Tiber navigable for ocean-going ships with draught of 5 meters along the border of the Church State and thence to the sea, within 2 years from ratification of the present treaty," which is a secret treaty, remind you. Further, in Article 5, "Papal ships can at all times navigate on the Tiber to and from the sea without being subject to the authority of the Italian state. Should Italy be at war, or should it for other reasons deem necessary to close the Tiber waterway to general traffic, a channel is to be kept open for papal ships, and river pilots are to be placed at their disposal. Papal ships shall be treated by the high contracting powers as extraterritorial in peace and in war, and not subject to interference by a foreign power." Bam! Here you have a way how they implied the Vatican red lines after World War II, because the Papal See, the Holy See, the Vatican, has had always access through the Tiber to the Mediterranean Sea. They could ship out anything, everything, and everyone they ever wanted without ever being checked and controlled. Article 6. "The Kingdom of Italy will pay to the Holy See within 6 months after the ratification of the present treaty the sum of 500 million lira to cover the cost of the papal court and of the administration of the Church State." Well, this 500 million lira, I think it is in the book The Vatican Billions by Avril Manhattan, if I'm not mistaken, that you can learn what the Vatican actually used this 500 million lira for. And otherwise, because I don't remember all the little parts of it, you can contact Tom Fress from Inquisition Update, tom@seawaves.us, and ask him the question, because I know that he knows of this. He spoke about this in earlier readings. I don't know if it was in the Global Vatican. I don't know if it was in its absolute last work up to now, which is Rome and Civil Liberty by A.J. Wiley, but he spoke of that before, because I spoke with him about that, but that was not on a broadcast, that was in private that we spoke about that. He knows that, but I think also it is in the book The Vatican Billions by Avril Manhattan. 500 million lira to cover the cost of the papal court and of the administration of the church state. Now, Article 7 of the still secret London Treaty. The sovereignty of the church state includes finances and jurisdiction. That, my dear listeners, is the reason why the Vatican Bank is the biggest money laundering bank in the world. You can go there and launder your money. You only have to pay 15% to them, and the rest is yours. But of course, it is not for quote-unquote lay people, but for governments, companies, and of course all the papal knight orders. And of course whitewashing the money from the CIA. Drug trade and everything. The sovereignty of the church state includes finances and jurisdiction. Yeah? Interesting treaty, eh? Now, Article 8. Diplomatic representatives of foreign powers accredited to the Holy See enjoy within the territory of the Kingdom of Italy the same privileges and exemptions as diplomatic representatives of the same rank accredited to the Kingdom of Italy. In case of a state of war or a break in diplomatic relations between the power they represent and the Kingdom of Italy, they have to take residence in the church state. And for confirmation of this, go to Tom Fraser's reading The Global Vatican. Francis Rooney, former American ambassador to the Holy See, admits and tells you stories about who was there during the Second World War and took residence in the church state of the Vatican. Very, very interesting. Because there, all intelligence agencies run together. Because they are, of course, all controlled by the Jesuit order. And there is no better informed intelligence agency in the world than the Vatican. Article 9. The high contracting powers after the ratification of the present treaty will invite all those powers which are not signatories of this treaty to recognize the temporal power of the Pope over the territories designated in Article 1, as well as the extraterritorial status of papal ships as provided in Article 5. Finally, Article 10. This treaty shall be ratified as soon as possible. Ratification documents will be deposited with the Holy See. The treaty enters into force on the day on which ratification documents have been deposited. Those were the 10 first articles of the secret Treaty of London of 1915 that you probably never ever heard about, and paved the way for the Lateran Treaty of 1929 that gave back the temporal, the worldly, the civil power to the Pope. It is not astonishing that the liberal government of Italy should have resented this planned infringement of their country's sovereignty by Germany and the Vatican. Nor was this all. Germany has never given without receiving. Only indirectly does Herr Erzberger inform his readers of the assistance which Germany had received and was to receive from the Holy See. Now we are speaking about an international Catholic committee. After Italy entered the war on the side of the Allies, Erzberger, so we are talking about the First World War, right? After Italy entered the war on the side of the Allies, Erzberger, as the Kaiser's chief of propaganda, organized in collaboration with an emissary of the Papal Secretary of State an international Catholic committee in which each country was represented by 5 or 7 delegates. Its object was to urge upon all belligerents that the territorial independence and the political freedom of the Holy See should be guaranteed in future peace. This International Catholic Committee and several of its subcommittees met repeatedly in Switzerland and Holland. Its chief purpose was to explain the German viewpoint to the world. Erzberger tells us that the high official of the Roman Curia, with whom he negotiated in Switzerland, was in charge of the exchange of prisoners of war. He was Monsignor Eugenio Pacelli, the present, in 1942, Pope Pius XII. Now we speak about a papal peace offensive. Still dealing during the time of First World War. Negotiations between Erzberger and Pacelli continued throughout 1916. In June of that year, Erzberger was, quote, asked by the German Secretary of State to inform the Vatican that the German government was willing to accept the good services of the Pope in the matter of peace and would appreciate them, unquote. He had once consulted with his friend, the representative of the Papal Secretary of State in Switzerland, meaning Pacelli, who believed that the time had come for winning the peace. But after the Vatican peace move had produced its first results, it was checked by a parallel intervention of the German Foreign Office through Spain. The results which Berlin wished to obtain in 1916 were only of a diplomatic and psychological nature. Germany was in fact merely trying to disintegrate the home front of the Allies and to obtain a clear picture of the political situation in the Allied camp. The papal peace move thus suited the Kaiser's purpose. In 1917, after Eugenio Pacelli had been appointed nuncio in Munich, Wilhelm II, the Kaiser of Germany, became more outspoken in his demands. According to Pope Pius XII's official biography by Kees van Hoek, published in London 1939 by Burns, Oates and Washburn, limited publishers to the Holy See, the Kaiser told Monsignor Pacelli, quote, that the Pope should mobilize the episcopate all over the world in a moral peace offensive and begin by using his special influence on Catholic states by promoting a separate peace between Italy and Austria, unquote. Jesuit propaganda among Protestants. Well, this could be an hour-long video of itself when we take into regard Vatican II between 1962 and 1965. But we won't do that here. Jesuit propaganda among Protestants. Erzberger's propaganda mission ended shortly after Pacelli had taken up residence in Germany. With laudable frankness, Erzberger tells us on page 7 of his book that he had been assisted by, quote, a number of Jesuit priests who rendered us extremely valuable services in enlightening foreign countries, unquote. Nor were these propaganda activities limited to the Catholic circles. It should be of interest to Protestants in America to discover that this prominent Roman Catholic politician, working hand in glove with the highest dignitaries of the Pope, also organized what was known as, quote, weekly evangelical letters, unquote. These letters were edited by Dr. Deismann, professor of Protestant theology at the University of Berlin, and were addressed especially to American Protestants. Says Erzberger, quote, Professor Deismann was very skillful in drawing up his mailing lists. We adapted the contents of these letters deliberately to American interests. Professor Deismann had reason to be satisfied with the response. The Secretary General of the Federal Council of Churches of Christ in America, representing 30 evangelical churches, church organizations with 125,000 communities, maintained close relations with him. unquote. This gentleman might not have done so had he known that these weekly evangelical letters were financed and, in the last instance, directed by propaganda chief Erzberger and his Jesuit assistants. Erzberger's assassination in 1921 had been planned for some time. The young fanatics who killed him were only the instruments of others who wished to eliminate this man who knew too much, who already had said too much, and who had been too closely connected with events in which the promoters of the present world war saw Germany's humiliation. The young fanatics who killed him were only the instruments of others. Well, look at the assassination of JFK, look at the assassination of Abraham Lincoln in your country, and then go into the conspiracy of the Jesuits by reading Charles Chiniquy's 50 Years in the Church of Rome, and understand that the Jesuit order through the Surratt family was behind the assassination of Abraham Lincoln, and that Booth was nothing else than a patsy, like the two young fanatics who killed Erzberger in 1921. It's all the same. Now we come to Pacelli's post-war activities, meaning post-war World War I. Monsignor Pacelli's stay in Germany lasted in all more than 12 years. He was in Munich under the short-lived Bavarian Soviet Republic, which he fought, and at the time of Hitler's first putsch in 1923, you know, the beer putsch, which put him into prison, and where he so-called wrote the book Mein Kampf, which was ghostwritten by Jesuit Father Stempfle, which we covered already in other chapters of this book before. When France occupied the industrial Ruhr Valley because Germany refused to continue reparation payments, the nuncio, though not accredited to Prussia, ostentatiously flew from the Bavarian capital to Düsseldorf in the Prussian Rhineland and induced his friend Achille Ratti, then Pope Pius XI, to publish an open condemnation of the Ruhr adventure. In 1925 he obtained a concordat with Bavaria, a concordat with Prussia in 1929, after his appointment as nuncio in Berlin, and in 1933, the famous concordat with the whole of Hitler's Germany, a concordat still in working today. Cardinal Pacelli, wrote Kees van Hoek, his official Catholic biographer in 1939, has always been known for his strong German leanings. Yeah, of course, because Pope Leo XIII already said that Germany must become the sword of the Roman Catholic Church, eh? Continuation of the same policy, huh? Thus it is that Germans and Italians now have good reasons for looking forward, hopefully, to Pius XII's mediation on their behalf. For his past history shows that, instead of condemning Hitler, whom he knew well during the 7 years of his stay in Munich, he negotiated a concordat with the Nazis just as he tried to negotiate one with the Kaiser's Germany during the last war. He fears German radicals as much as his predecessors feared the Bolsheviks. Like Pius XI, he is connected with the fascist bourgeoisie through his family. His uncle, a famous banker, was the founder and guiding spirit of the Banco di Roma, one of Italy's greatest banks and investment houses. His brother, Francesco Pacelli, who drafted the Lateran Treaty with fascism, had more than 100 secret conferences with Mussolini before the treaty was signed. The papacy undoubtedly can and will survive the present fascist setup in Italy, but in the lifetime of Eugenio Pacelli it will continue to support Italy's vested interests and will continue to remain pro-German under any kind of a regime, provided it is not anti-Catholic, provided it is not Protestant, provided it is not anti-Catholic. As long as Germany has a regime that is obedient to the Roman Catholic Church, they don't have to fear very much. Today, papal diplomacy is again busy behind the scenes. Judging by its record in the last war, and by the personal leanings of the present Pope and his Jesuit advisors, the Curia is not the disinterested and elevated tribunal which it is made to appear to Americans. The Pope, too, has a political axe to grind. By propagating the idea that the Pope as Chief of Christendom, read Chief of Catholicism, is to be Dean and Arbiter of the future Peace Conference, clerical politicians, however, may render disservice to their cause. Protestants as well as Orthodox Catholics, who do not believe in any Chief of Christendom, might come to learn that the Allies in London in 1915, after all, were not so ill-advised. And this brings us to the end of the book Behind the Dictators. 12 chapters going on for 75 pages, because I leave out the appendix, a vital condition for lasting peace. You can read that for yourself. I do not even consider this a part of the book. I said everything that I have to say concerning this book. And as I stated in the beginning, I loved reading this because the history that is told in this book is, in the first part, very important for my German brethren to understand why the Second World War, why the Nazis' Third Reich was what it actually was. And secondly, as a warning to my American brethren, that they see the dark clouds on the horizon coming up to their country, as Germany has experienced with 12 years of Nazi fascism. Complete Jesuit rule. Complete. This is the same that will happen in the United States of America. And the groundstones have been laid in 1776. And now they come into fruition. Beware, America. Beware, Protestants. Beware, Bible-believing Christians all over the world who read this book, who listen to this book, me reading it, commenting on it, study it, and learn that there is nothing new under the sun, but that history repeats itself. When you know the true history revealed in this book, you can understand where and when history repeats itself. And a warned person is worth two, is a saying that we have in German. Thank you very much for your attention, for watching, for listening, for commenting. I'm already looking forward to my next work that I have laid out for myself, the next book that I'm going to read. I will not mention that here. I will make a teaser video in time. But I can tell you already right now, my next two projects in the English reading will be very, very interesting. And God willing, I can do it. So pray for me that we will keep the internet, that I can keep my internet connection, that I can bring this necessary truth out in the betrayed world as it is today. And for the rest, make your peace with our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. First and for all, study the Bible. don't study men's teaching. Study God's teaching. He tells you in his true reserved word up to today, in the 1611 King James Bible, what to do and what not to do. Adhere to God, not to men. Be very, very careful who you listen to. And always take into recognition to eat the meat and spit out the bones. Jogla 66 from Hour of the Truth, signing off. God bless you. Bye-bye.